There are different kinds of modes of treatment. The most commonly thought about is you got a stereotype in your head about what therapy is, right? And the stereotype in your head probably involves a couch, right? That would be normal because that's what the media portrays therapy to be. But we don't use couches. I might have a couch in an office I work in, but you ain't got to lay down on it. In fact, I would prefer that you don't. I would like you to maintain your attention while we talk, if you don't mind. Laying down is not something we do. That was something way back in Freud's day. Literally, that was a Freud thing to do. Modern mental health care involves no such thing. It no longer requires also that you stay 50 minutes. The 50-minute hour, the idea is that ideally you would come once a week for 50 minutes, where the last 10 minutes is the provider writing up notes about what happened. So that's all confidential. It's put into a chart so they remember what's going on the next time they see you. And you would go for as many times as you deem necessary. That might be one time. That might be 50 times, whatever you think is necessary. But the idea is that you see a provider one-on-one in a confidential setting, and that's individual psychotherapy. And that's the typical thing that people think about. But keep in mind that there's all kinds of misconceptions. You can't fall in love with your therapist. You can't date your therapist. Your therapist can't date you. I saw that movie, what was that, 50-50? And the woman who supposedly got a doctorate is now, he's like, is this your first patient ever? She's like, yeah, come on. Seriously, this woman would have had 6 years of training probably prior to a full-time position with multiple supervisors, multiple classes, tons of experience, and a code of ethics that says, I'm sorry, I cannot date you, as a foundational precept. So all kinds of misconceptions about what these mental health care providers are. They're not paid friends. They're not going to be your buddy, not going out for coffee. They are trained professionals to help people work on their issues themselves. And that's usually how it's done, is in individual psychotherapy. You can do it in group. Usually in group, you're looking at 4 to 10 clients, patients, whatever you want to call them, who are usually strangers to each other in the typical group setting. But over time, they're going to learn to trust one another. They're going to share problems, get feedback, improve interpersonal skills. And in so doing, it can be more powerful. It's hard to get people to go see an individual therapist because it's already kind of awkward and weird to go meet a stranger and start talking about deep issues. Can you imagine going and doing it with 5 or 6 strangers who were not trained professionals? That's the idea behind that. But there is research that shows that that could be a very helpful way to do it. Number one, it's cheaper for the patient. Number two, there's some interesting kinds of effects you can get in groups that you just can't get one-on-one. One is that you start to realize that you're not alone. A lot of people who suffer think, I'm the only one going through this. And when you get in a group of 4 or 5 people that look normal, you realize that lots of people go through stuff, and just looking at people doesn't mean that they're not suffering. Just because they don't appear to be suffering in day-to-day life does not mean that they are free from suffering, and that you can see that other people go through the kinds of things that we go through as individuals. So you get some kind of shared support. You also start building potential relationships, although it's a confidential situation. You're not supposed to have relationships with your group members outside, but people do because they're not trained. They're not professionals. They're not bound to ethical codes. They can do what they want, but that's not the goal. And there's a certain insight that can come from this that just can't be provided by an individual therapist. I have an anecdote to share with you that kind of opened my eyes to that. I was working with a guy at a counseling center for, I can't remember how long it was, probably 4 or 5 sessions. He had massive panic attacks. He had been emotionally and physically abused by his father all the life that he could remember. He was now going to college, and I was seeing him at a college counseling center, and he had panic attacks all the time. And he had really low self-esteem. I mean, terribly low. He just thought he was not worth anything more than his father thought he was worth, which was not much of anything according to him. And so he just had this terrible time of life because his thought patterns were, I'm piece shit, nobody cares about me, and that makes total sense because I'm not worth caring about. So you don't have a whole lot of hope if that's your belief about yourself. But I saw him as a smart guy, a nice guy, a pretty decent looking guy, and a guy that could be really friendly and helpful and engaging and really all these positive qualities. That's what I saw. Being objective, not having an agenda. He didn't come across in any other way except positive, nice guy. And I gave him that feedback as an individual therapist. I'm like, well, I see that you think of yourself this way, but these are the perceptions I'm having that don't line up with that at all. And he's like, well, I've been seeing therapists for a while, man. You're just my therapist and you're paid to say that. I'm like, I'm actually not paid to say that. I'm just telling you what I perceive to be the case given the time that we spent together. But he dismissed it as irrelevant or inaccurate or not genuine. I convinced the guy to get into a group. It was really hard to convince him to do it, but he did it. And after about 5 or 6 sessions in the group, these other people started telling him exactly the same thing. And he started tearing up. Because you know what? They weren't paid to tell him anything. And he couldn't get away from the fact that those were their genuine thoughts about him, and that they were really positive thoughts about him, and that they were totally contrary to what he believed about himself, which made sense given the circumstances he grew up in. But having grown past that, he didn't need to hold on to that incorrect view anymore. Couples therapy, that's when you work with two different individuals that are in a relationship together. That's a group, right? It's more than one. Family therapy, that's when you work with the systems. The system is the group you come from, the people that you are involved in some level. It could be biological, could be adopted, could be just living together and roommates and things like that. People that are working or living with you and are part of your life. So it turns out it helps to talk to those people collectively and not just look at one person as a problem, but that we oftentimes find ourselves in systems that are problematic or chaotic or difficult to navigate, and it might help to work on that whole system. So that's MELU therapy, where you're really working with a team of professionals on a variety of treatment approaches. Let me see what else we got here. All right. We're getting right up on time. We're still below our actual time that we quit. So, main treatment categories, know the difference between inpatient and outpatient. Inpatient is when you're basically staying for the night. It could be a hospital, it could be a lockdown ward, but it's because somebody's needing mental health treatment and they're a danger to themselves or others, or they have very intense psychotic processes, or they're trying to detox from alcohol or drugs, and they need that inpatient setting where you get intensive services and you stay at the site until you're discharged. An outpatient would be any other mode of therapy that you get. And then with regard to inpatient treatment, it's really expensive. And so when we look at things, and I talked before in previous sections of material about how hard it is for people to quit substance abuse. Well, it turns out that expensive inpatient treatment might be equal to less expensive outpatient care. And additionally, we find that the 12-step program is the one that is used most often. No matter whether you were inpatient or outpatient, the 12-step recovery model is the one that's used most frequently to help people with substance abuse problems. It's not a professional program. It is a non-professional program by definition. It is run by lay people, not professionally trained people. It's not even run by paraprofessionals. It's run by people who are overcoming their own addictions. So they become a network to each other. They become a support system to each other. Now, there are some difficulties with it in that it's faith-based. The faith is your choice, but it is faith-based, so it doesn't fit everybody who might not be faith-based. And it's very social, so it's kind of hard for people who are really shy to do this. And sometimes it can be clicky. Not every group is not wide open and very accepting. And it's also based on a disease model where abstinence is the only goal. So you can't just reduce use, you have to quit use altogether. But for those it fits, it can be very helpful. It can be very, very helpful, and sometimes it's the only thing people have to offer. And so it's better than nothing. It was pioneered by Alcoholics Anonymous's Bill, and it's been applied to cocaine, narcotics, marijuana, dual recovery, sexual compulsives, overeaters, gamblers, debtors, workaholics, codependents, emotional difficulties, you name it. They've applied the model to it when people have difficulties, and it can be helpful, but abstinence is the goal. Y'all study hard, and I will see you in here on Wednesday at 1:20 to do that final exam. Have a wonderful day and a great weekend.